الله الرحمن الرحيم. This is the last lecture about the physiology of the excitable tissue. In this lecture, we will talk about the motor nervous system, in which we will describe the higher center and the lower center of the motor nervous system. As we said before, the nervous system is divided into two main parts: the central nervous system, which is present in the skull and spinal cord; the peripheral nervous system, which includes the peripheral nerve fiber that supply the organ of the body. These peripheral nervous system could be either motor nerve fiber or sensory nerve fiber, and the motor nerve fiber could be autonomic or somatic nervous system, and the autonomic could be parasympathetic and sympathetic. In this lecture, we will talk about the central part in relation to the motor nervous system, the peripheral nervous system related to the motor activity, the motor nerve fiber, and the somatic motor nervous system. Starting from the higher center, since we are talking about the motor nervous system, we will start from the higher center. And as we said before, the cerebral cortex contains the central sulcus. Behind the central sulcus is the sensory cortex that we mentioned in the previous two lectures. While in front of the central sulcus, we have the motor area. And this motor area represented by the frontal loop, and it contains many areas: prefrontal cortex, primary motor cortex, secondary or associated motor cortex, and so on. All the motor activity which are related to the voluntary act is starting at the cerebral cortex. So, when we are talking about the higher center, we are talking about the brain. And the brain represents the site for planning, initiation of movement. And after planning of the movement, then the initiated impulse will descend downward through two pathways, either through the pyramidal tract or through the extrapyramidal tract. The pyramidal tract will send the impulses from the brain to the alpha motor neuron, and these alpha motor neurons are present within the spinal cord, while the extrapyramidal tract will end at the gamma motor neuron, which is also present in the spinal cord. The alpha motor neuron will send their axon to the neuromuscular junction that we mentioned in the previous lecture, and the impulses in the neuromuscular junction will lead to contraction of the skeletal muscle and initiation of movement. While the impulses which descend down through the extrapyramidal, it will go to gamma fiber, and from gamma fiber it will go to the proprioceptive receptor. One of these proprioceptive receptors is the muscle spindle, and this muscle spindle will regulate the contracted skeletal muscle. Will regulate means increase or decrease the force of contraction according to the posture, according to the need of the subject. Accordingly, when we are talking about the organization of motor nervous system, we should talk about the planning and initiation of movement in the brain, the pathway which sends the impulses to the lower motor neuron, which are present in the spinal cord, and how does the gamma fiber produce regulation of these motor activities. The impulses which goes down from the brain to the lower motor neuron, that is to say, toward the spinal cord, passing through four main tracts. These are the pyramidal tract, the extrapyramidal tract, the cerebellar tract, and interconnecting nerve cell between the cerebellum, basal ganglia, and the thalamus. All these tracts will send the impulses to the spinal cord, and in the spinal cord there will be coordination between all these impulses to get specific regulated and planned movement of the muscle. Accordingly, the descending tract include the pyramidal, extrapyramidal. The pyramidal is coming down from the cerebral cortex, the extrapyramidal coming down from other area of the brain other than that of the cerebral cortex. The cerebellar tract comes from the cerebellum, and the interconnecting, it will share the impulses between the cerebellum, basal ganglia, and the thalamus. Starting with the first tract, which is the pyramidal tract, and this is representing a system that we call it as a pyramidal system. This pyramidal system or pyramidal tract is started in the cerebral cortex at the precentral gyrus, and the impulses will descend down either by a spontaneous discharge from these cells in the precentral gyrus, or these cells send their impulses according to input from the sensory area, so that the pyramidal system produces initiation of movement or sending of impulse for movement either by themselves or through input from the sensory area. About 80% of the movement should be regulated by the movement regulated by the sensory nervous system. Then, this nerve fiber, which is started in the precentral gyrus, and then it will descend down at the medulla oblongata, there will be a process of decussation. Decussation means crossing of these nerve fiber, and after decussation it will descend downward into the spinal cord in such a way that the right hemisphere, right side of the brain, will control the left side of the body, and the left side of the brain will control the right side of the body. So, in the arrangement of the pyramidal tract, 80% of the fiber are crossed and descend down as the lateral corticospinal tract, and 20% of the fiber will descend downward without crossing as the anterior corticospinal tract. These fiber, which descend as the anterior corticospinal tract, as it reach the segment which supply the specific muscle, it will cross to the other side. So also it will be crossed, but the crossing will occur before its termination within the spinal cord. This pyramidal system, as we said, represent impulses which is initiated in the precentral gyrus. The cell which control the body is arranged in such a way. The left side or the left hemisphere of the brain will control the right side, and the right side will control the left side of the body. So we call it right to left. Also, it is represented like that of the sensory nervous system, upside down, which means that the nerve fiber which control the movement of the lower limb is present at the upper pole of the precentral gyrus, while those which control the face and the tongue are present on the lateral limb or downward on the lateral side of the prefrontal cortex. The other property of the arrangement or representation of this pyramidal system is unilateral innervation. All the muscles are supplied by unilateral pathway from the cerebral cortex down to the muscle, except the upper part of the face, which is bilaterally represented. It is supplied by two sides, which means that the forehead of the subject is supplied by the right and left hemisphere of the body, while the rest of the muscle are unilateral innervated. The left side is supplied by the right hemisphere, the right side is supplied by the left hemisphere. The other property of the arrangement of the motor nerve cell is that the area of the cerebral cortex that control part of the body is proportional to the fine movement, which means that since the tongue is responsible for fine movement, the finger are responsible for fine delicate movement, the face is involved with the fine delicate movement. So the cell which control these skeletal muscles are very large in number. It is proportional to the skillfulness that is produced by that specific muscle. The function of the pyramidal system. We say that the pyramidal system, which is started in the cerebral cortex, descend down, crossing to the other side, descend down into the lower motor neuron in the spinal cord. What is the function of this system? It is responsible for fine, delicate, skillful movement. Any movement which is delicate, fine, and neat precision are produced or controlled by the pyramidal system. So that if we cut the pyramidal system, it will not produce paralysis, because skeletal muscles have two types of movement. Either a skilled movement, like for example, lifting a very thin paper from a table, or writing, or fixing a watch, fixing a certain instrument by your hand, all these need the pyramidal system. If we cut it, we will lose this function, but still we have the gross movement, so that there is no paralysis but loss of skill, fine movement. In addition to that, if we cut the nerve fiber of the pyramidal system, there will be loss of the associated movement. You know the gait, which is the movement of the body. During movement of the body, we are moving the left hand with the right leg, moving the right hand with the left leg. This is called the associated movement. If we look on a subject who got CVA, then this patient, when he walk, he cannot move the affected limb with that of the opposite leg, so that there will be loss of the associated movement. Instead, those patients, if they lose the fine delicate movement, their movement will be clumsy, which means there is loss of precision of movement, and it will produce as a grasping, rubbish type of movement. The other property that occur when there is cut of the nerve fiber which is coming from the pyramidal system, there will be hypotonia. Hypotonia means decrease in the tone. This character is opposite to all other type of upper motor neuron disease. Generally speaking, in upper motor neuron disease, which is disease of the higher center, there will be an increase in the tone. But in pure damage of the pyramidal system, there will be hypotonia, decrease in the tone. As you see in this picture, there will be floppy muscle. They will lose their innate tension. There will be loss of the tension. Another property that we can observe on clinical examination in patients with pyramidal system, we will find that there will be what is called as dorsiflexion Babinski reflex. In Babinski reflex, we are scratching the foot. Then this patient, we will get fanning of the finger toes, and there will be dorsiflexion of the foot, dorsiflexion of the big toe. This is called dorsiflexion Babinski reflex. In normal subject, if we do scratching of the foot, then there will be adduction of the toe and plantiflexion of the big toe, plantiflexion of the foot. We said that there are different pathways from which are responsible for motor activity. We mentioned the pyramidal system, and now we will talk about the extrapyramidal pathway. The extrapyramidal, from its name, extrapyramidal, خارج pyramidal system. And this means that all the motor fiber which descend downward from the brain to the spinal cord, which are originating away from the cerebral cortex, we call it as the extrapyramidal. The extrapyramidal, and in another word, the extrapyramidal tract are the tract which is starting from basal ganglia, red nucleus, reticular activating system, vestibular nucleus, superior colliculus, that is to say, outside the cerebral cortex. These are called as the extrapyramidal pathway. What is the function of the extrapyramidal? We talk about the pyramidal, and it is responsible for fine, delicate movement. The extrapyramidal is responsible for programming and initiation of movement, responsible for control of gross movement, regulation of body posture, and regulation of the tone. As we see here, it is responsible for programming and initiation of movement. It is also responsible for gross movement, so that if we got damage of the pyramidal, we will still have the gross movement of the extrapyramidal system. And this gross movement includes not only voluntary act, but it is including an involuntary act, that is the regulation of posture of the body and regulation of the tone. If there is damage of the extrapyramidal system, then there will be either positive signs, which means that there are movement of the body which is uncontrolled by the voluntary act, like for example tremor, irtiash, tremor of the finger, or there might be a negative sign due to loss of initiation of movement, so that the patient will get slow initiation of movement, that we call it hypokinesia. Hypokinesia, يعني slow initiation of movement. Sometimes we will get also an increase in the tone of the muscle and the stiffness of the muscle. These signs and symptoms can be seen in disease that affect the basal ganglia, like Parkinson's disease. In Parkinson's disease, there will be tremor, resting tremor, there will be slow initiation of movement and termination of movement, and there will be increase in the muscle tone and stiffness of. Starting with the first function of the extrapyramidal system, programming and initiation of movement. The movement is planned at the prefrontal cortex. This is the site of the planning of the motor activity, of the movement, of the plan of the act that we will start to do. Then these impulses are sent to the precentral gyrus and motor cortex, and then from the motor cortex it will descend down in the deep tissue of the brain in the basal ganglia, and this basal ganglia will form a program for the plan to do the motor activity. These basal ganglia are formed of many nuclei, caudate nucleus, globus pallidus, putamen, subthalamic nuclei. In addition to that, there are another area which is added as the same function of the basal ganglia, which is the substantia nigra and red nuclei. To summarize what we are talking about, the function of the extrapyramidal system is programming and initiation of movement. To get programming of impulse, we should have a plan, which is started in the prefrontal cortex. This plan are firstly sent to the motor cortex, to the precentral gyrus, and from the precentral gyrus, it will be sent to the basal ganglia. After doing a program for this movement, it will send again into the cerebral cortex and descend downward through the pyramidal system to get movement of the body. The other function of the extrapyramidal system is regulation of posture, position of the body, position of the different part of the body during rest and during movement, so that the postural control occurs through the activity of a specific type of receptor involuntarily by two type of reflexes, either static reflex or phasic reflex. If you are sitting on the chair, then there are impulses which are sent continuously from the extrapyramidal area through the extrapyramidal tract to reach the muscle spindle, and this receptor will keep the contraction of the extrafusal muscle fiber, keep the contraction of the skeletal muscle constant during sitting position. When you start to move, when you are moving, you will have change in the tone of the muscle. Increase the tone at the leg, which is holding the body, and decrease the tone on the other side. Then you put the other leg on the ground and you will lift the first leg. And this means that there is decrease in this tone in the other side, and so on. This occurs also through the phasic reflexes that produce changes in the tone of the muscle according to the movement of the body. We said that regulation of posture and tone of the body occur by specific type of receptor that we call it as muscle spindle. These receptors are present in parallel with the fiber of the skeletal muscle. They are responsible for regulation of the length, the tone in the skeletal muscle. These muscle spindles are containing intrafusal skeletal muscle fiber, and also it is supplied by two types of nerve fiber. One is the motor fiber, which comes from the gamma motor neuron in the spinal cord, and also it contains sensory nerve fiber, which sends the impulses to the higher center to produce the reflex activity. This muscle spindle, as we said, is formed from intrafusal muscle fiber, sensory nerve fiber, and motor nerve fiber. How does this receptor produce its effect? As we said, it is present in parallel with the skeletal muscle fiber. The ratio between the length of the muscle spindle and the skeletal muscle should be always kept constant according to the regulation of posture of the body. So that, for example, if the muscle spindle length is 1 and the length of the skeletal muscle is, say, 100, this ratio 1 over 100 should be kept constant. If there is sudden stretching of the skeletal muscle or sudden contraction of the skeletal muscle, shortening of the skeletal muscle, this ratio will be changed. And accordingly, the muscle spindle will send impulses to the higher center to produce contraction or relaxation in the skeletal muscle to retain the ratio to its normal value, which is 1 over 10 or 1 over 100, whatever it is. The tract that sends the impulses from the extrapyramidal system, that is to say the basal ganglia, the red nucleus, the different area of the extrapyramidal system into the spinal cord, can be divided into 4 main tracts. These are the tectospinal tract, which is starting in the tectum and tegmentum and descend down into the spinal cord. Rubrospinal tract, which is starting from the red nucleus. Reticulospinal tract, which is started in the reticular formation to the spinal cord, and vestibulospinal from the vestibular nuclei. As you see here, these nuclei are all control the body, the posture of the body, and control the tone of the muscle involuntarily according to the function of the vestibular nuclei, which control equilibrium, reticular nuclei, which control the sleep and wakefulness, red nucleus and tectus. All of them are regulating the activity, the muscle contraction, according to the change in the tone of the muscle involuntarily. Now we come to the other part of the higher center, which controls the movement of the body. That is the spinal cord. The spinal cord, as a cross section, is formed of two parts, the gray matter and the white matter. The gray matter is formed of nerve cells. It is gray due to the presence of the nuclei and DNA. And these cells, which are present in the spinal cord, in the gray matter of the spinal cord, either sensory cell, motor cell, interconnecting neuron, autonomic cell, and connective tissue cell. We mentioned the sensory cell, and we said that it is present in the dorsal horn. The motor cells are present in the ventral horn. The interconnecting neuron connect the sensory with the motor, or connect the different segments with each other. The autonomic cell, we said that it is present in the lateral horn and the connective tissue, which is binding the different cells with each other. Next, we have the white matter. This is the white matter of the spinal cord, and this white matter is formed of myelin of the nerve fiber. So the white matter contains, instead of the body of the nerve cell, it contains ascending or descending nerve fiber, so that the white matter is formed from ascending or descending or interconnecting nerve fiber that connect the different segments with each other. So that the cross section is formed of cell in the gray matter and nerve fiber, which is the ascending and descending and interconnecting nerve fiber in the white matter of the spinal cord. The function of this part of the nervous system, function of the spinal cord. The spinal cord represents a midway between the peripheral nervous system and the higher center, which is the brain, cerebellum, cerebrum, basal ganglia, so that the spinal cord will carry the information, carry the motor information, motor impulse, from the higher center, from the central nervous system, to the peripheral nervous system. And at the same time, it carries the sensory impulses, sensory information, from the periphery, from the receptor, to the central nervous system. So, it is representing a midway between the peripheral and the central nervous system. So, it carries the information, motor and sensory information. The other function of the spinal cord is the presence of center, which are responsible for specific function in the body, and we will mention the center. Next, we have the coordination of movement. As we said moment ago, that the descending fiber, pyramidal and extrapyramidal tract, they are ending into alpha motor neuron and gamma motor neuron, and the coordination of these descending impulses will occur within the spinal cord. The other function of the spinal cord is the reflex activity, and we have many reflex that occur within the spinal cord. The first function, as we said, carry motor impulses from the central nervous system to the periphery. And this is started as impulses is originated in the motor cortex or in the basal ganglia. Then these impulses, which is started either in the subcortex or in the basal ganglia, will descend downward within the spinal cord. So it is representing the descending fiber that sends the impulses from the higher center, which is the subcortex, or the basal ganglia, to the neuron which are present in the spinal cord. There are two types of neuron: alpha motor neuron, which supply the skeletal muscle, and gamma motor neuron, which supply the muscle spindle. And by excitation of motor with the muscle spindle, we will get coordinated movement in the skeletal muscle. So the function of the spinal cord is responsible for carrying the impulses from the higher center downward into the lower center. These are the impulses which are originated in the subcortex and the basal ganglia, will end into alpha motor neuron or gamma motor neuron to get contraction or organized contraction of the skeletal muscle. The second function of the spinal cord is carrying information, sensory information, from the periphery to the central nervous system. Sensory impulses of different receptors, pacinian corpuscle, pain, temperature, vibration, proprioception impulses, these are ascending higher up within the spinal cord, to the higher center, like the thalamus, the subcortex, the cerebellum, and the transport of impulse occurs through the specific ascending tract or ascending fiber. Generally speaking, we have two main ascending tracts. That is the lateral spinothalamic tract, from its name, the spinothalamic. It is started in the spinal cord and ending into the thalamus. So, we have the lateral spinothalamic tract, and we have another tract that we call it as the dorsal column. The dorsal column will end at the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, which are nuclei present in the medulla oblongata. This tract or pathway, the lateral spinothalamic tract, is specific for carrying certain sensation like pain, temperature, and light touch, while the dorsal column is responsible for another type of sensation, that is the proprioceptive, the vibration, and the crude touch. Accordingly, according to the type of the sensation and the pathway, we have a specific pathway for each type of sensation. As we said, it is the spinal cord is responsible for carrying sensory impulse from the periphery to the central nervous system. And as the impulses passing from the skin through the dorsal root ganglia, it will be segregated, it will be divided. Some of the fiber will go upward to the higher center through the dorsal column, and another nerve fiber will cross to the other side and ascend higher up through the lateral spinothalamic tract. The other function of the spinal cord is the presence of centers. Centers means collection of nerve cells, which is responsible for a specific function, like urination center and defecation center. These are collection of nerve cells which are present at the sacral region. When they are stimulated, this nerve cell, which we call it our center, urination center or defecation center, once it is stimulated, it will induce urination or it will induce defecation through the center, which is collecting of nerve cell within the spinal cord. As we said, the defecation center and urination center are present within the spinal cord, mainly at the sacrolumbar region of the spinal cord, and they will send impulses through the parasympathetic nerve fiber that produce contraction of the bladder and urination or contraction of the rectum, and defecation will occur. The other function of the spinal cord is coordination of movement. Impulses descend downward from different areas of the cerebral cortex, like from the cerebral cortex, another impulse comes from the cerebellum, other impulses are coming from the vestibular nuclei, some other neurons are originated from the receptor, sensory receptor, that go to the spinal cord. So the cell within the spinal cord will receive many impulses, some of them from the cerebral cortex, some other from cerebellum, some from the vestibular nuclei, some from the receptor. All these impulses, as it reach the terminal pathway, which is the alpha motor neuron, it should be coordinated, regulated, to get specific type of movement in the muscle, specific type of contraction. And this coordination occurs as another function of the spinal cord. We will give an example how can the different impulses coordinate the movement. Suppose you are trying to lift a jar from a table, and you think that this jar is full of water. So you will send impulses through the cerebral cortex in order to produce a forcible contraction. But unfortunately, this jar does not contain water, so it will be light. So if this subject does not know that the jar is empty, then the movement will be stronger than enough, and it will produce disturbance in the movement of the limb. So that coordination of movement need impulses from different area, and these impulses are coordinated within the spinal cord to get the specific type of muscle contraction. The other function of the spinal cord is reflex activity. And the reflex, as we said in the previous lectures, it is an involuntary response to sensory input. And this response of the reflex could be either motor movement or it could be glandular secretion. In order to get any reflex in the body, whether it is somatic reflex or autonomic reflex, in order to get such a reflex, we should have normal receptor, normal sensory nerve fiber, normal spinal segment, motor nerve, and effector neuron. If there is damage of one of these sites of the reflex arc, there will be loss of reflex activity. If there is damage in the reflex, in the receptor, or sensory neuron, or motor nerve fiber, or spinal cord segment, or the effector organ, there will be disturbance in the reflex activity. As you see here, this is a diagram representing the spinal cord, the gray matter, the motor nerve fiber, which is the alpha motor neuron, the sensory nerve fiber from the receptor through the dorsal root ganglia into the dorsal horn, and from the dorsal horn interconnecting neuron to the alpha motor neuron. This pathway from the receptor through the cell nerve cell, sensory nerve cell, through the interconnecting, through the motor nerve fiber, is called as a reflex arc. Any damage, any interruption in this reflex arc will lead to loss of the reflex activity. As you see here in the next diagram, this reflex activity may be initiated by stimulation of sensory receptor. For example, in this picture, there is stimulus in the form of fenugreek, and this fenugreek will send sensory impulses to the spinal cord, and this will produce immediate motor contraction, and this will produce lifting of the hand from the site of which produce the stimulation. The type of reflexes, somatic reflex. The reflex that occur in the body, we divide them in the previous lecture as somatic reflex and autonomic. The somatic themselves are divided into two types, either monosynaptic reflex or polysynaptic reflex. From its name, monosynaptic means there is one single synapse between the sensory and motor nerve fiber. An example of the monosynaptic reflex is the bicep jerk, supinator, triceps, knee jerk, and ankle jerk. An example of polysynaptic reflex is the painful reflex and the blinking reflex. We can illustrate these different reflexes simply by a diagram. This is the monosynaptic reflex. Once we do stimulation of the receptor, this is the receptor, which is the muscle spindle. Once we stimulate this receptor, it will send impulses directly into the alpha motor neuron that produce contraction of the muscle, so that there is one single synapse between the sensory nerve fiber and the motor nerve fiber. This is the monosynaptic reflex, like the knee jerk, ankle jerk, bicep jerk, tricep jerk, supinator jerk, and so on. We have this tendon jerk, hitting of the tendon of the patella, sending impulses through the sensory nerve fiber due to stretching of the muscle spindle into the spinal cord that produce contraction of the skeletal muscle. This monosynaptic reflex will produce another type of reflex within the same stimulus that produce the contraction. This is called as polysynaptic because there is more than one synapse that produce the activity. And this occurs to produce relaxation in the antagonistic muscle. Hitting of the tendon produces stretching of the patellar tendon, stimulation of the muscle spindle, contraction of the quadriceps. But at the same time, there should be relaxation of the hamstring, and this occurs through the branch from the sensory nerve fiber, which end at the butyl Golgi neuron, and from this butyl inhibitory neuron, it will produce inhibition of the hamstring muscle. Another example of monosynaptic is the bicep jerk, which is occurring through the 5th and 6th cervical segment and cervical root, the supinator at C5 and 6, knee jerk at lumbar 2-3, ankle jerk, which occur at the segment of lumbar 5 and S1, sacral 1, the tricep jerk at C5, C6, C7, the tricep jerk occurs through C6, C7 rather than C5, C6 segment of the spinal cord. I repeat it another time. Tricep jerk are regarded as C6, C7 segment. We see that there is monosynaptic and polysynaptic. One example of the polysynaptic is the painful reflex. For example, this young man is walking and he got pain that stimulates his foot. Immediately, there will be flexion of the knee, pulling of the leg upward, and there will be change in the movement of the hand, and sometimes there is even jumping. And this occurs due to the fact that the sensory stimulation will produce stimulation of many segments of the spinal cord, and each segment supplying a specific muscle, either in the same limb or in the other limb, so that the single sensory nerve fiber will produce excitation of many segments, so it needs many synapses to produce this effect, and we call it as painful reflex. These reflexes have many properties, and these properties include adequate stimulus. Adequate means the tendon jerk need tendon hammer to produce stretching of the muscle spindle, while the reflex that produce painful stimulation need specific stimulus, which is panic, for example, or increase in the temperature by heat of a candle or heat plate, and so on. So that for each reflex, we have adequate stimulus that induce this reflex. The other property is specificity and stereotyping, which means that if we hit the patellar tendon, it will produce movement of the leg itself. But if we do, if we hit the biceps, it will produce contraction of the upper limb. If we do stimulation, painful stimulation from the outer side of the leg, it will produce movement to the inner side, and so on. So that there is a specificity of the response, and the direction is indicated by the direction of the stimulus. The other property is central excitation and central inhibition, which means that the stimulation is excited by central nervous system. Like, for example, if you are afraid from painful stimulation, once you see the pin, you will have increase in the reflex activity, and opposite to that, inhibition can be done voluntarily and trying to stop the reflex activity. Habituation and sensitization. It is an involuntary response of the body in which there will be decrease in the response or increase in the response. Localization, and this depends on the position of the organ of the body, whether it is in flexion position or extension position. Fractionation and occlusion. Once we do stimulation, severe stimulation, it will produce a response in many segments, and this is called as occlusion. For example, if we do scratching of the foot of the subject, he may got, if the scratching is very weak, it will produce movement of the foot by itself. If we are increasing the scratching, it may lead to movement of the leg upward and downward. And if you do more stimulation, it may lead to movement of the other side, and even sometimes it induces urination as a result of mass stimulation of the spinal cord, and this is what is called as fractionation and occlusion. Rebound phenomena, which means that there is a function which is opposite to the first function due to the loss of inhibitory effect. Like, for example, if you press on the hand and immediately you remove your hand, then the subject may fall down due to loss of the resistance. Irradiation of the stimulus, when there is spread of the stimulus, excitatory stimulus, to the other area of the spinal cord. The other properties that occur in the motor nerve system function is the muscle tone. And this muscle tone is regarded as a partial state of involuntary muscle contraction. And this is depending on the presence of the reflex arc. As we said a moment ago, if there is interruption of the reflex arc, then there will be loss of the tone or decrease in the tone of the muscle. Decrease of the tone can occur either by cutting of the sensory nerve fiber, cutting of the motor nerve fiber, damage of the spinal segment, damage of the muscle, damage of the receptor, any lesion alongside the reflex arc, it will produce decrease in the tone of the muscle. And this decrease in the tone is called as hypotonia or flaccidity. And generally speaking, this occurs, as we said, due to damage of the spinal segment, which is called as lower motor neuron lesion. On the other hand, when we talk about the damage in the cerebral cortex or damage in the basal ganglia, it produces hypertonia or increase in the tone. So, upper motor neuron disease, generally speaking, produce hypertonia. Lower motor neuron disease in the spinal cord, it will produce hypotonia. Increase in the tone normally occurs due to the loss of inhibitory effect of the upper motor neuron. If there is normal upper motor neuron, it will produce an inhibitory effect to the specific receptor and the tone will be normal. If there is cut of this inhibitory effect, there will be increase in the tone, as it has happened in disease of the upper nervous system, damage of the certain area or the pathway of the gamma.